On Sunday mornings, we're talking about false teachers and how men do not study the Bible. That's why we're in the apostasy. There's a great falling away. And let me just write the word apostasy down on the board again. The apostasy is why men don't learn. This is exactly the reason right here. Apostasy. When Paul said that the day of the Lord will not come except there come a falling away first, the word falling away is the word apostasis, A-P-O-S-T-A-S-I-S. Now, I've said so many times what that means. It comes from apo and stasis. The apo means a total removal of the stasis. From stasis, we get stand. And from that word stasis, we get staros, S-T-A-U-R-O-S. That is the word cross. So, apostasis is a removal of the cross. And that is the daily cross. Men don't try to move the wooden cross of Jesus. They remove the cross that crucifies self. And Paul said that's the cross in the sixth chapter of Galatians, by whom the world is crucified unto me and I unto the world. And he said, that's the preaching of the cross to them that perish foolishness. And of course, foolish is M-O-R-I-A, Moriah. And we get the word M-O-R-O-S, and that is comes from the word moron. We get our word moron, and that means a simpleton. Moros means a simpleton. The word Moriah is the word there in 1 Corinthians, the first chapter, 18, the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. That word Moriah means absurd. It's absurd to tell a man to take his cross and die. Now, this is why men, apostasy is why men can't learn the Word of God. They can't learn because of this, huh?
Put a T on that can.
Can't learn, yeah. This is why they can't learn the Word of God, because they removed the cross. How do you learn? How do you learn? Doesn't Luke 14:27 say, if a man does not bear his cross, that's daily Luke 9:23, he cannot be my disciple? Isn't that what it says? Looking at it from this viewpoint, the word disciple is mathetes. Mathetes, and that means a learner. That's exactly why men can't learn. They remove the learning process. No cross, no disciple, no learner. Mathetes, we get our word mathematics. So when you remove the cross, you remove your learning. If you go into a trigonometry class, you have to remove all opinions and listen to all the instructions from the trig book. You have to listen to all the instructions of the teacher. When you go into a music class, when your kids come into music class, do you let them just say, well, I don't think the treble clef is F-A-C-E. I don't think the spaces are F-A-C-E. I think they're H-E-A-D. Or I think they're F-O-O-T. Is that okay? Huh? No. It's F-A-C-E, isn't it? Or E-G-B-D-F? I don't think that's E-G-B-D-F for the lines. I think that's L-X-Y-0 spot 4-0 blue. Yeah. You think that? You're going to fail. You have to crucify and listen to Sid teach you music. And he'll teach you some real complex theory. If you really want to get that far, you can't go into a classroom and have an opinion. And that's what's wrong, is opinion, and men leave their cross and they leave the process of learning. That's all it is. That's why men today, the apostasy's here, there's no daily cross. And Paul said these men, they're enemies of Christ. They hate the cross because they mind earthly things, and when your mind is on stuff and things, you can't learn. That's all that's wrong. And of course, we get the word stao, that means to stand, and we get the word histemi, that's histemi, that word means upright. The problem is they have no faith. They don't believe God. They all got wishing, but they have no faith. Faith is hypostasis. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. Hypostasis, that's how you learn, by dying. Faith, hupo, means to continue in the stasis. That's the word substance, Hebrews 11 and 1. So if you're going to learn, you have to define the words, you have to crucify self and say, I don't care. You don't take a vote and see if Billy Graham believes it. You don't say, well, the Southern Baptists don't believe it, so I don't see how in the world it could be right. And you're just one man against the world. Well, guess what? Martin Luther was one man against all of Germany. You can't learn. All I am is a learner. I am not an authority. I keep saying that. There are no authorities in the world on the Greek language. I'm going to say this for the TV audience. Here's Liddell and Scott's Greek-English lexicon with about 45,000 Greek words. Don't any of you Greek teachers tell me you learned all this. You haven't. You got over 5,600 words just in the Strong's Concordance. And don't even tell me you've learned all of them, because you haven't. Who do you think's learned 5,600 words yet? Whew. You'd have to study your whole life, wouldn't you? I know a lot of them are compound words, but nobody's learned all this. We are learning this together. And I only learn what I teach, and I'll never teach you something that I don't study. Now, a lot of people come up to me and ask me questions like, you're the authority. No, there is no such thing. I'll tell you about what I study, and if I say I don't know, somebody called me the other day and said, what does this mean? I said, I don't know. And I'll tell you that, but if I start telling you something, it's because I've studied it. And I'm going to crucify myself, and I'm not going to ask Billy Graham or Jack Van Impe or Hal Lindsey if they believe it. I don't care if Charles Stanley believes it. If the Bible says it, and we go back to the original text of Receptus, and it says it. And if you can show me something, you can teach me, because people teach me all the time. If I'm on the phone to a six-year-old, if I'm on the phone with Corey, and he's, what, 12 or 13, and he says, starts saying something to me, I don't know. So wait a minute, Corey, let me write that down. I will learn from everybody in this group. If you say information to me, I'll say, wait a minute, where'd you get that? Have I said that to people here? Haven't I had said to people, would you bring me a copy of that? But too many preachers, yes, you're the church member, and I'm the preacher. Yes, that's good. You're doing good, young man. I've already got it down. I don't have everything down. We're talking about, and the reason men don't understand the 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians, let's go back there, is because what this is talking about in the 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians, I noticed something this morning, and oh man, the hair upon the head was called the crown. And what is the crown of our head? Huh? Well, that's right. That was called the crown. Now, you've got two words for crown. You got the word diadem, and you have the word Stephanos. We're going to talk about both of those this morning if we can get around to them. Those are the words for crown, and neither one of them ever means those tall pointed crowns of Nimrod that's got diamonds and jewelry in them that kings wear. They don't mean that. Neither one of them mean that. Now, those are evil crowns. Those horns, when the kings wore these pointed crowns, those were the horns of the bull that Nimrod slew and he started Babel. And that has nothing to do with diadems or Stephanos. Stephanos were the oak leaf that everyone who ran the races got a Stephanos, a crown. Everyone who ran the race got a Stephanos. And we're going to win the crown. Now, look here in 1 Corinthians 11. I saw something last night. I was reading this. You have to look back at the previous chapters to be able to tell the exact context. I believe what Paul is giving us in the 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians is a picture of the spiritual Nazarite, is what he's talking about. Let's start reading here in the 11th chapter, 1 Corinthians. Be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Christ. Followers, the word mimetes, M-I-M-E-T-E-S, M-I-M-E-T-E-S, mimetes. We get our word M-I-M-E-C, mimic, and that word mimic means to copy someone, as Paul said. Now, why was he saying this? He was saying this because of the previous chapter. You have a hard time living. What does a Nazarite have? What is, uh, What is the requirements? Do we remember the requirements of the Nazarite? Let me read you some things about the Nazarite. I'll tell you what let's do. Before we do this, let's go over to Numbers, the sixth chapter. Number 6, and let's read the Nazarite vows, okay? Number 6. Okay, number 6. Number 6. And let's read here in verse 1. The Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, when either man or woman shall separate themselves. Now, first of all, when you're talking about Nazarite, it has to do with separation, doesn't it? Nazarite has to do with separation. And there's two common words that I think of in the New Testament. Can y'all remember what those are when we're talking about separation? Hagios or hagiazo, H-A-G-I-A-Z-O. That word means to sanctify. We get the word saint from that. In fact, it's the same word as saint, hagiazo, and the word H-A-G-I-O-S, which comes from that, and that's the word holy, and that means to be one or single. And we get the word H-A-G-N-O-S, hagnos, and that word is the word pure. When a man is pure, he's separated from the world. You remember over there in when Paul said that over in the 6th chapter of 2 Corinthians, when he said, what fellowship does light have with darkness, or Christ with Belial? He says, we're not to be unequally yoked with unbelievers, but come out from among them and touch not the unclean thing and be separated. He said, separate yourselves and I will receive you. Those are the words of God to a priest. I'll receive your offering when you separate from the world. And that word separate, and when Paul said I was separated from the womb, that is the word aporizo, A-P-H-O-R-I-Z-O. Aporizo is the word separate. That's the common word in the New Testament Greek for the word separate. God has separated us. He's going to cause us to be holy. How is he going to purify us or hallow us? When we say hallowed be thy name, hallowed is the same word as sanctified. It's the word hagiazo, and the word name is the word onoma in the Greek, and that means authority. Wait a minute. We're talking about the authority in the 11th chapter, 1 Corinthians, aren't we? Who is the authority of man, or the head of man? The head of man is Christ. The head of the woman, or the authority of the woman, is man. Now, when we're talking about name, we're talking about authority, aren't we? So whenever you're talking about authority, you're talking about being separated to the authority or to the name of Christ. Now, when we're separated, this word aporizo comes from apo. Apo means a total horizo. Now, sometimes the word apo will mean complete. Sometimes it has the connotation of being total. In this case, it means a total horizo. Horizo, of course, we know that. We know what that word is. Horizo is this word horizon, or it means to bound. And prohorizo is the word over there in Romans 8 and 29. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate, or prohorizo, or prebound. He prebound us. And the prebounding goes on in our lives by separation. And the word Nazarite is the word Nazir, N-A-Z-I-R. And that word means to separate. That's what it means. To separate oneself and cleanse oneself. Now, don't you notice something about the Nazarites? Because you're going to find in the 8th through the 10th chapter of 1 Corinthians, you're going to find the very image. What does Hebrews 10 and 1 say? Hebrews 10 and 1 says that the Old Testament was a shadow. The New Testament is the very image. When you go out in the sunlight at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, I've said it so many times before, you will cast a shadow. Which is the real, the shadow or you that cast the shadow? The shadow is not the real. The Old Testament is not the real. The Old Testament Nazarite is not the real. That's the shadow. The New Testament separation is the very image. Because that word Nazir means separate. Now notice some things about the Nazarite. And what are we talking about? About a Nazarite? Hair. What you eat and what you drink. Isn't that right? Wait a minute. I think the 10th chapter of 1 Corinthians talks about what you eat and you drink. Wait a minute. Doesn't, after he's talking about the adorned hair in the 11th chapter, doesn't he go back to talking about eat my flesh and drink my blood? Is that what he talks about? Eating and drinking of truth, except you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no life in you. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He's talking about the hair and eating and drinking, isn't he? And the hair was said to be the crown. What are we going to receive? Crowns. Not pointed crowns. Who is the crown that we're going to receive? Christ is the head of the church, isn't he? He's the crown of the church. And the hair on the head of the Nazarite was said to be his crown. Now, when we receive crowns, we're receiving... Who did Paul tell the Thessalonians his crown was? He said, that's what he said. He said, you are my joy and crown. Now, he didn't go around. When you get to heaven, you're going, God's given me real strong legs and a real strong back because I got all these Thessalonians on my head. Or I've got... Paul told Philippians 4:1. He said, Philippians, you are my joy and crown. Well, what's he carrying on his head? He's got a bunch of Philippians on his head. It's not talking about literal crowns. Who gets the glory? I had one guy say, yes, when I get to heaven, God is going to give me many crowns. Like you accomplished it. How can you get what Christ does in you? How? It is God that works in you both willing to do of His good pleasure. So if He's doing it, why would Paul get more reward than anyone here that goes to heaven? You mean if God had wanted you to be Paul, He couldn't have made you that Paul? I will receive no more rewards than Corey or than any of these little children here who are believers. Not one ounce more. All God requires of each person is whatever gift he's given to them. Nobody's going to get no more than anybody else. Why would we? Because it's our accomplishments. Is that it? No. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. Now, let's go back here and read. I want to write some things up here because as we go, we're going to have to go back. We're talking about adorned hair there in the 11th chapter, and we're talking about what you eat and drink. And adorned hair has to be long, but the Nazarite wasn't to be doing things to his hair, adorning it. God gave it to him for his crown. Now, let's read here. Speaking to the children of Israel and saying to them, when either man or woman shall separate themselves to vow a vow of a Nazarite. Separate. As we go, this word separate is the word Nazar. N-A-Z-A-R. Well, guess what word that comes from? It comes from the word Nazir. See, all these things are related together. When he shall separate themselves to vow a vow of a Nazarite, of a Nazir, N-A-Z-I-Y-R, or it's actually Nazir. There's no A and I's, there's no vowels in the Hebrew language. To separate themselves, that word, the second word separate is Nazar. To separate themselves unto the Lord. He shall separate himself from wine and strong drink. Now, this is not talking about the pure blood of the grape. The Jews said that the purest thing they put on their lips was the pure blood of the grape, and strong drink was when the scripture says wine is a mocker, strong drink is raging. Whosoever is deceived thereby is not wise. Strong drink was the same thing that we call white lightning. It was homemade brew, and it was made out of the hops and the barley harvest. They made it from the wheat harvest and from the barley, and it was supposed to, they said the strong drink of the Jews would just knock you down. It'd make you so drunk you'd be totally out of your mind. Well, are we not supposed to be, we're not to be drunk, are we? Hold your place right there and go over to Ephesians. Hold your place. We're not leaving this at all. Go to Ephesians. Go to Ephesians, fifth chapter. We're not to be drunk, are we? We're not to be drinking. You will never, ever find where God ever puts His approval on drinking any intoxicating beverages, ever. When you look at the word mingle, those who mingle themselves, when the seed of Israel mingled themselves with the pagan peoples of the lands and they intermarried, that was a mixed religion. The strong drink had to do with mixing. When you mixed a wine that was drunken, most people do not know that they had to reduce the grape juice to a must. We would call it a concentrate. Bury it in the ground and keep it cool in order to keep it from fermenting. If grape juice fermented, left out in the open, grape juice could not be drunk because it would get sour. You had to mix enough water, enough sugar with it, and it had to be aged at lukewarm temperature. And Jesus tells the church at Laodicea, "You're lukewarm. I'll vomit you up like a drunken elixir," and you never find drunkenness from God's perspective ever. And what we are spiritual Nazarites. And the hair upon our head is our crown, and the hair is a picture of Christ. Christ is a picture of the hair, because when Samson had his head shaved by Delilah, when his head was shaved, it was said that the Lord departed from him, or his crown departed. Now, let's read here in the fifth chapter, verse 18. Most people use this verse to show that it's okay to drink as long as you don't drink too much. No. It says, "Be not drunk with wine." He's not simply saying don't be drunk. He's saying don't drink it, because he says, "Wherein is excess?" Wherein is excess shows that he's talking about spiritually drunk, because the word excess is the word A-S-O-Z-O, isozo. The word sozo is the word saved. What must I do to be saved? When you place the alpha privative, the alpha, A-L-P-H-A-P-R-I-V-A-T-I-V-E, alpha privative, in front of a word as a negative particle, and when you look that up, it'll say from the negative particle, it negates the word sozo. It means don't act like an unsaved person, you Ephesians. He is not talking about it's okay to drink as long as you don't get drunk. He's talking about spiritual, because he, look at the next part of the verse. He says, "But Be filled with the Spirit." Now, first of all, the opposite of being not drunk with wine wherein is excess is to be filled. Be filled. Now, you cannot be filled until you are emptied with anything, can you? You can't be filled until God empties you. And that, I always think of two words with empty. I think of the word PTO. C-H-O-S, that is the word poor. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. And that word tokas has the connotation of a beggar holding out his hand saying, "God, whatever you would have me to have." And what's the other word we think of when we think of emptied? Don't we think of the word K? E-N-O-S-I-S. Jesus made himself of no reputation, be filled with the Spirit. The opposite of being drunk with wine wherein is excess, the opposite of being drunk with wine wherein is excess is not being drunk with seagrams. That's not the opposite. The opposite is being filled with the Spirit, isn't it? But be filled with the Spirit. So when you're not acting like an unsaved person, the way to act saved is be filled with the Spirit, and the Holy Spirit is the truth, isn't it? Truth. So be filled with the truth. How are you going to find truth? Take your cross and die, and you will learn the Word of God. Don't be filled with a mixture. Let's go back over it very quickly to 1 Timothy, and then we'll go back to the Nazarite. 1 Timothy, look at this. 1 Timothy, now Paul was writing to Ephesus. Evidently, there was a lot of mixed religion going on over there. This equates with the Old Testament where the Lord would say, don't go intermarried with those people. Don't go intermarrying with the sun worshippers when you go back into Canaan. And the Scripture says that they mingle themselves. Now, a drunken elixir, the way to make a drunken elixir is you have to have so much water, so much grape juice, if you're going to make it out of grape juice, so much water, so much grape juice, so much sugar, and it has to be aged at lukewarm temperature, 50 to 70 degrees. Has to be lukewarm. Now, I want you to look at this. This is talking about judgment, judging. Now, we're to separate from the world and stay pure. He says in verse 19, against an elder, receive not an accusation, but before two or three witnesses. There we are back to the two and three witnesses, aren't we? Takes in a fifth chapter, 1 Timothy. Them that sin, the elders, rebuke before all. Now, some people say, but up there in the first verse it says, rebuke not an elder, but down here it says, rebuke an elder. These two words, rebuke, are two completely different words. The word rebuke in the first verse is the word epipleso, E-P-I-P-P-L-E-S-S-O, and it means to cover with a pleso, and this word pleso means to fabricate. And we get our word plastic from the word pleso, and it means to beat a man into submission. It means to strike. You remember when the Scripture says, if a man desire to be a deacon or to have the office of a bishop, of a presbyter, he's not to be striking men and using the Bible to beat men into submission. That's not what we're supposed to do. What we're supposed to do is study the Word. And the second word, rebuke, in the verse 19, against an elder receive not an accusation, but before two or three witnesses, them that sin, the elders of the church that sin, rebuke them publicly before everyone. People say, you're not supposed to call people down and call names. That word rebuke there is the word elenchos, E-L-E-G, E-L-E-G-C-H-O-S. That means to show evidence of the man's guilt, public evidence. So whenever somebody says, rebuke not an elder, and then down here says, rebuke an elder, it's because rebuke are two different words. And if you don't study and look these up, and the woman that wrote me a letter said, you're defining words, and don't you think that you just don't need to do that to find the truth? Well, you better do that with these two words, rebuke. Them that sin, rebuke before all, that others also may fear. I charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ and the elect angels that thou observe these things without preferring one before another. He's saying, don't be partial, do not respect persons because you're getting impure. I've got something marked in my Bible. I can't remember exactly. My old Bible. I've got to get it up here. Y'all have to excuse me. And hold on a second. There it is right there. Oops, that's Ephesians. Close to it. Ephesians, now you got to remember, Paul is talking to, Timothy is pastoring at Ephesus, and we just got through reading in Ephesians, the fifth chapter, about being not drunk with wine wherein is excess. He's talking to Timothy, the preacher of that same group of people, and evidently they were participating in a spiritual drunkenness. And he's talking to Timothy, preaching to him. He's pastoring at Ephesus. Now, look here in the next verse. He's saying we have to keep ourselves pure in judgment or separated from all of our opinions. We have to be really spiritual Nazarites. Now, here he says in chapter 5, let's read on here. He says, chapter 5, I charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ and the elect angels that they observe these things without preferring one before another, doing nothing by partiality. Keep your judgment pure. We're to judge righteous judgment. There in John 7:24, the word judge is K-R-I-N-O, krino. That word means to decide guilt or innocence. If we're going to separate ourselves unto the Word of God, we must be pure just like the Nazarites, and we can't drink any strong drink just like the Nazarite. We're going back there in a minute. Lay hands suddenly on no man. What he is saying, I have read everybody under the sun, and they think that just God just went off in space when he said this. Went. Here he is talking about judging righteous judgment, and they'll say, means lay hands suddenly on no man to throw him into the ministry. No, he's talking about judging. He's saying, and who are you going to lay hands suddenly on to persecute him? Your enemies? Is that what we're going to do? We're going to be partial to our friends, our mother, and our brothers, and our sisters, and our boss, and the pretty girl, and the handsome guy, and the guy that's glib. We're going to be partial to him. The guy that's not quite as handsome and not as pretty, and he's got don't have a flashy personality, and maybe he's the guy next door that we just don't think that he's what he ought to be, and he's not a Christian. We're going to judge him severely. Don't go out judging him before you put him against the backdrop of the Word of God, and don't judge your friends until you place them using the Scriptures to screen them with. Don't be partial. What does he say? He says, lay hands suddenly on no man. Don't judge your enemies by grabbing them and condemning them quickly, neither. Now, the opposite of laying hands suddenly on no man is comes after neither, doesn't it? Neither be partaker of other men's sins. How do you partake of other men's sins? You put your approval on them, don't you? You bid them Godspeed, don't you? If anybody brings any other doctrine, in 2 John 10, do not bid them Godspeed. Godspeed is the word C-H-A-I-R-O, and that means to be cheerful to them. Who is it we have a tendency to be cheerful to? Our friends, guys we like, the pretty girl, the handsome guy, our boss, our mother, our father, put everyone. They must be evaluated against the Scripture only, not your opinions. And then what does he say?
Keep thyself hagnos, pure,
separated. Be a good Nazarite.
Now, he didn't go whacked out in space on the next verse. He's still talking in a spiritual vein. He says, Timothy, drink no longer water. Don't mix the earthly. Water had so much connotation among the Jews. He's saying, don't mix. Water was always a picture of worldly things. If it was not pure, their waters were laid stagnant. They'd stagnate in the cisterns, and they had to get pure water, or to get, if it doesn't say pure water, living water, he's saying drink no longer water. He's not saying don't drink any living water. He's saying don't become drunk in the world. He didn't just go nuts out there in space and say, but use a little wine for thy stomach's sake. Little wine, that goes back to keep thyself pure. He says, and thine often infirmities, and it goes back. He doesn't go back. He's still talking about judging in verse 24. Some men's sins are open beforehand, going before judgment, and some men they follow after. He did not just stop in the middle of this verse. His context and his connotation is not mixing the things of the world. When he speaks of the water, he's simply talking about it takes water to make a drunken elixir. But he stands, stay pure. Now, I read this out of, I believe it was McClinic's and Strong's, or it was out of one of my sets of dictionaries, that they said the purest thing they put on their lips was the pure blood. In fact, it's found over here in Deuteronomy. Let's go back to it. Deuteronomy 32. Deuteronomy 32. 32. Spiritual drunkenness, Deuteronomy 32. There's no way, I believe he's telling Timothy, it's okay if you drink a little alcoholic beverage as long as you don't get drunk. It's no continuity in the context at all. That's exactly right, Steve. Look here in Deuteronomy 32. The Jews said the purest thing they put on their lips came from the grape. That's because they wanted the deep water from the wells. When Jesus went to the woman of the well in John 4, he said, if you'll ask me, I'll give you living water. Living water was running water. They had several things they called living water. They called the semen of the man living water. They called the blood living water. Jesus called himself living water. The mountain streams was called living water or pure water. And when our hearts are washed with pure water and we're washed by the word there in John 15 and in Titus the third chapter, we're washed with the living water, the pure water, Christ, the blood of Christ. The word semen, we get the word seminary. And when the Bible says the seed is the word of God, that's the word sperma, that's Christ. We get our word sperm from that. And that's the conception that happens to us at new birth. We're washed. And there we are back to the blood baptism, and that's death to self, and that's the cross. And that's no apostasy, but hypostasis is what it is. Now, look here in the 32nd chapter, look here in verse 14. Butter of kine and milk of sheep with fat of lambs and rams of the breed of Bashan and goats with the fat of kidneys of wheat, and thou didst drink the pure blood of the grape, not mixed with water. The word pure is a really, really interesting word. It's the word C-H-E-M-E-R, Kimur. When the Ark of Moses, not the Ark of Noah, the little basket that Moses was put in, when that was pitched in Exodus, the second chapter, that is the same word, Kimur. It means to smear. Smear with pitch. That's what it is. Very interesting, isn't it? Smear with pitch. And the pitch is what the ark was pitched with. And what's that? That's baptism, isn't it? It sure is. That's baptism. So when we're smeared with the pitch, we're baptized and we're kept pure. And what's that? That's blood baptism, isn't it? And that's the same thing as a cross. And that's what makes you learn, isn't it? You can't learn otherwise.
Is that the same thing as anointing?
Same thing, yeah. The word anoint means to be smeared all over. That's right. So whenever, when he says keep yourself pure, this word is the same word. This is the pitch of the ark. When you look up the word pitch or kimur, it'll tell you that was a term for the pitch. So when he said, thou didst drink the pure blood of the grape, they're being pitched within, aren't they? And we're pitched within and without with pitch. Pitch with pitch means to cover with a stain or a dye, and that is the same meaning as baptism. And there we are, back to baptism right there. And what is baptize? Jesus said, can you be baptized with the baptism I'm baptized with? And he's talking about a cross. He said, when we're baptized into his death, what was his death? A cross. That's how we learn, isn't it? And what does that do? That separates us, and we die. We're separated from the world, and we become pure because we learn the Word of God. And we become spiritual Nazarites. That's what we become. And this has to do with what we're eating and drinking, doesn't it? Well, guess what the 10th chapter of 1 Corinthians is about? It's about eating and drinking, isn't it? Let's write this down. Let's go back over here to the Nazarite vow, okay? I want to write this down, and then I'll go back to the 10th chapter, because you can't get to the 11th chapter, 1 Corinthians,
Really, I taught on that last week, but you can't get there till you get to the 10th chapter, can you? Nope, you can't. Now, first of all, let me erase some of this and let me write these points about the Nazarite down, okay? I'm going to write these down. It's Nazir, it's the word Nazarite. Who was the first Nazarite in the Bible? Does anybody know? No, there was... Most people think it was Samson. But it wasn't. No, it was Joseph.
Joseph?
Yeah, he was the first Nazarite. Yeah. It doesn't say that. But it does say that. We'll get to it in a minute, okay? Now. Yeah, Joseph was the first Nazarite. Let's keep it complex, okay? Now, let's go back to the Nazarite. First of all, the Nazir. First of all, he is going to separate himself. Separate self. God has to separate us. In the Old Testament, that man set himself up for separation. Of course, God called Samson and separated him, and he called Samuel and separated them. And those are the only two mentioned as Nazarites. But if you get into the word Nazir, you get into Nazarite. And you got the word Nazir throughout the Old Testament scripture. It's just translated into different English words. Guess what? Mm-hmm. That's good, isn't it? I like that. Yeah. Now, look here, let's read. He shall separate himself from wine and strong drink. What did we just talk about? Be not drunk with wine, when is excess, but be filled. You think God changes? If there's a shadow in the Old Testament, is there a New Testament very image? Yes, there is. Who would that be? That would be us. Now, first of all, no wine or strong drink. No wine or strong drink. And that's talking about spiritual. That's talking about spiritual. Now, I did the study on the strong drink years ago. I know what that is. That is corn liquor. That's what they would call it. No wine or strong drink. And that is spiritual. Well, if God doesn't want us to drink spiritual drunkenness, don't you ever think that they were drunk there at Pentecost? God never told anybody to get drunk. And what did Peter say? He said, this is just the third hour of the daylight day. It was 9 o'clock in the morning. Their daylight day started at 3 o'clock. He said, these are not drunk as you suppose. They're filled with the truth. Nope, you're never going to find where God ever puts his approval on drunkenness, ever. When anybody tell me that's spiritually drunk, God says, do not be drunk spiritually. In fact, if I went into the word mingle, you look up, take your word mingle and look. Just look at one of them here, very quickly, over here in Isaiah the fifth chapter, very quickly. So first of all, we're not going to drink strong drink spiritually. They didn't drink strong drink literally. Okay. Isaiah 5, I'm going to try to explain this. It's so much to it. I thought I was going to get back to the long hair. Of course, it's not long hair. It's adorned hair. We said it last week. Now, Isaiah 5, verse 20. Here's when a man is spiritually drunk. Woe to them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light. And why is it they do that? Or a lie for the truth. Darkness for light. Remember, aporizo, we are separated unto light. The word horizon means it's the division of light and darkness. And ye were darkness, but now are ye light? Light is equated with truth. Truth is something we do. Light is something we walk in. And light for darkness, but bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Woe unto them that are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight. He's talking about spiritual things, isn't he? And look at the next verse. He's still spiritual. He's not going to literal. Woe unto them that are mighty to drink wine, and men of strength to mingle strong drink. And look at the next verse. Which? He says, here's
what the spiritual drunkenness does from verse 22, it takes you to 23, which justify the wicked. Wait a minute, that's putting our approval on their sins, isn't it? Be not partaker of other men's sins. Don't bid them Godspeed, because whoever bids them Godspeed, 2 John 10 says, don't bid men Godspeed who bring another doctrine. They're drunk. Don't you get drunk. If you bid them Godspeed and you're cheerful to them, he said, you are partaker of their evil deeds. You're taking on their mixture, aren't you? So what he's saying, mixing strong drink is when you justify the pretty girl, your boss, your brother-in-law, your sister, your mother, for what they can give you, or your Baptist preacher, and you justify the rich men in the congregation for their offerings and their money. You justify the wicked for a reward and take away the righteousness of the righteous from him. That's mingling strong drink, isn't it? That's not being a spiritual Nazarite. Now let's go back to the Nazarite.
Why did Jesus turn the water into wine?
He didn't turn it into booze. You're going to have to go into the word wine. There's many words for the word wine. That's not what he did. You will never find that. You're thinking wine, aren't you? Wine. Yeah, well, that's not what, they didn't have that back then, and they had to store it. And the new wine was pure blood of the grape. Now, we think, we got English on the brain, don't we? That's what you got on the brain. You think wine, you think ferment. That's not what they thought. That's what you're thinking. That's not what was going through their mind when they said wine. They thought many kinds of wine. They thought the pure blood of the grape, and they thought ferment, and they thought strong drink. They had many different kinds.
The priest said, well, you saved the best wine for last.
Yes, but that was the pure. What was the best thing they could put on their lips? The pure blood of the grape. You're back there. The pure. They said that was the best thing. And the reason was, during the hot seasons, they had to keep them in cisterns, and it would ferment, it would stagnate, and that's why David sent a man across the lines to get across the battle lines to get some water out of the well of his father's, didn't he? And he poured it out as a drink offering to the Lord. When you think wine, don't think the way they thought. Don't think the way you're thinking. Don't think English. You're going to have, what we'll do is we'll do a study on wines. I don't have time to do that this morning. I've got a book on wines of the Bible. It is not what we're thinking. We think wine, we think something gets you drunk. That's not what they thought. You got English going on up here. That's not what they had going on up here. Now, where were we? Okay. Now, he says that they justify the wicked for a reward and take away the righteousness of the righteous. That's spiritual drunkenness. Let's go back to the Nazarite in chapter 6. Verse 3, Numbers. He shall separate himself from wine and strong drink, and shall drink no vinegar of wine or vinegar of strong drink, neither shall he drink any liquor of grapes, nor eat moist grapes or dried. All the days of his, you notice what he's having to do? It's what he's eating and drinking, isn't it? Eat, now look here, number 2. It's what we eat, isn't it? Right? What we eat? And what do we eat as spiritual Nazarites? Nomos. We eat of the law of God. Nomos is the word law. It means legal food for sheep. Legally prescribed food. It's the law. All the law is fulfilled in one word. Even in this, thou shalt agape thy neighbor as thyself. And agape is walking the commandments of a king. 2 John 6, herein is agape, herein is love, that we walk after his commandments. So it's eating and drinking, isn't it? Now, all the days of his separation shall he eat nothing that is made of the vine tree, from the kernels even to the husk. All the days of the vow of his separation there shall no razor come upon his head, until the days be fulfilled in which he separateth, Nazar, each one having that word separate, separator, separated, Nazar himself, unto the Lord, he shall be pure. Same thing as Paul said in the 5th chapter of 1 Timothy, keep thyself pure in your judgment.
separate. He shall be pure or holy and shall let the locks of the hair of his head grow. Number three, long hair. He's got to have long hair. He's got to have a crown on his head, doesn't he? Now, we're talking about adorned hair in the 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians. What are we talking about in the 10th chapter before we get to the long hair? Let's go back and look at it. 1 Corinthians, let's go back. I believe Paul is talking about the spiritual Nazarite here in the 10th chapter. Let's look at the 10th chapter. Now, what did he say was upon the head of the man? Christ? Was Christ the head? And Christ was called the glory of God, wasn't it? Isn't that right? We said last week in Hebrews 1 and 3 that he was the glory and the express image of his person, and the heavens declare the glory of God, which is Christ. Man's glory is dumb. Paul said in Philippians, the third chapter, he said, all the things that I accomplish is skubalon, S-K-U-B-A-L-O-N. That is dung. It means rubbish. It means cast out. He said, I was a Hebrew of the Hebrews. I was a Pharisee of the Pharisees. He said, I was of the tribe of Benjamin, circumcised the eighth day of Israel. He said, I was not a proselyte. I was as good as you could get. And all that's dung. And what eats up dung? Salt. Salt. They put the salt on the dung heaps. You remember that in the last couple of verses? If the salt has lost its savor, it's neither fit for the dung hill. You remember? Savor is the word M-O-R-A-I-N-O. What destroys the glory of man? The skubalon. The moreno. That is the word savor. Savor, and that comes from the word M-O-R-O-S. An empty-headed simpleton. We are fools for Christ. The salt has lost its savor. It eats up the glory of man. Man takes no glory when he takes his cross and die, because the preaching of the cross is to them that perish. Moriah, it's absurd, and you're a moron. And that destroys the dung heap, or our glory. And the glory upon the head of man was Christ, wasn't it? Oops, let's back up just a little. Look at verse 31. Chapter 10. Whether therefore ye eat or drink, before we talk about long hair in the 11th chapter, or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God, not to the glory of man. For those of y'all that heard the message last week, this is talking about what we're eating and drinking. Give none offense. Don't offend anyone. Keep yourself separated. Watch out what you eat or drink. Don't be like the literal Nazarite Samson. He curled his hair in tresses. He began to adorn his hair. And then he began to play with the harlot of Babylon. As soon as you get involved in your own glory, he began to glorify his own head. He began to glorify himself, and eventually God had to shave him of his glory, didn't he? Now, chapter 8 through chapter 10 is talking about man bringing his body into subjection in verse 27. Paul of chapter 9, he said, if I don't bring my body in subjection and eat and drink the way I'm supposed to eat and drink. And it's whether we eat the nomos, the word of God, not whether we're eating of our food is spiritual food. Now the law is spiritual, and what used to be unlawful, those things, the scripture says everything is to be received with thanksgiving. He's not talking about whether you eat bacon or whether you eat pork or whether you eat, whether you eat bacon or whether you eat beef or whether you eat lamb. He's talking about whether we eat the nomos. He's not talking about whether you drink Pepsi or whether you drink
He certainly doesn't want us to be out here drinking Seagram's or one of those other liquors. He's talking about whether we're drinking a mixed elixir as spiritual. Look here. Go back over here in verse. Let's go back to chapter 8, 1 Corinthians. Chapter 8. See, before you get to the long hair of chapter 11 of 1 Corinthians, you're going to have to understand Paul is giving us a picture. Doesn't he talk all through here about spiritual Passover? He also talks about being a spiritual Nazarite. He also talks about atonement. He also talks about spiritual baptism in 8, 9, and 10, doesn't he? He talks about spiritual Passover in chapter 11, doesn't he? Because he's quoting from the 26th chapter of Matthew when he says he took bread and blessed it and broke it. And he said, take, eat, this is my body. And he said, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. And what were they eating when those words were quoted from Matthew 26? They were eating the Passover. He's got spiritual Nazarite here. He's got spiritual Passover here. He's got the spiritual atonement here. He's talking about a baptism in chapter 10, isn't he? Paul is just simply preaching Old Testament truths in the spiritual. Look here in verse, let's look at this. Look in verse, chapter 8, verse 1, 1 Corinthians. Now it's touching things offered unto idols. You remember over in one of the churches there in Asia was eating things offered to idols? What do we eat when we eat what's offered to idols?
Self.
We eat of self, don't we? Yeah, look here. Now the word idol, the word idolatry is E-I-D-O-L-O-L-A-T-R-E-I-A. Idololatria comes from ido meaning to see, and latruo, L-A-T-R-E-U-O, L-A-T-R-E-U-O. That word latruo means to serve. This means to serve what you look at. If you keep your eyes on the wrong thing, the Nazarite wasn't supposed to be mixing with the world. He wasn't supposed to be looking at the world. He was supposed to be separated from the world and not mixing himself. And his glory was God, and he was eating and drinking of truth. Except you eat my flesh and drink my blood. Eat and drink. Eat and drink. Indeed. My flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed, and indeed is A-L-E-T-H-E-S. And that is the word truth. And when you eat and drink of the truth, it comes from lanthano, that means to lie hid. And how are you going to find out the things that are hidden? You take your cross and die and you become a learner. A mathetes, a disciple. That's what's wrong with the world. They don't have a cross because it's foolish. And it's foolish and it's the savor. And it'll destroy the dung or the glory of man. The glory was the crown. It was Christ. The word in the Old Testament, glory, comes from the word kabod, K-A-B-A-D. K-E-B-O-D. That word kabod means something that's weighty. Well, the New Testament tells us, Paul tells us in the fourth chapter of 2 Corinthians, he says, our light affliction works for us a far more and exceeding eternal weight of glory. It's more eternal than this. And the glory is not man's head. Without the head, we wouldn't be able to decorate and put our makeup on, put our cosmos or cosmetics on. We wouldn't be able to put on, men wouldn't be able to spray their hair and get it back just right. We don't even know what truth is anymore. We've changed so much. I said to somebody the other day, I talked about how we changed from the 40s. In the 40s, black wavy hair was considered very beautiful, wasn't it? Isn't that what the women used to say? Al, black wavy hair. He's got lots of weight, huh?
Tall, dark, and handsome.
Yeah, and they'd say, and lots of wavy hair like Liberace, Mr. Sandman. And they write that in songs, wavy hair, and the women say, look, he's got black wavy hair. Well, we don't think that's pretty, that pretty anymore, do we? Everybody needs it straightened.
Right.
Aren't we? Yeah. Yeah. Now, look here. He says, as touching things offered unto idols, we know that we all have knowledge. Knowledge puffeth up. He's saying, just to have knowledge and not impart it to people correctly puffs up. But charity edifieth.
Now, charity is doing the knowledge, isn't it? Because charity is agape, and knowledge, that is walking in the commandments. That's walk in the commandments. That's our walk, and knowledge is G-N-O-S-I-S, and that word means science or something that's exact. Well, if we know the word, but we don't walk in it, we're worthless. So what he's saying, charity is what edifies, and the word edify is O-I-K-O-D-O-M-E-O. Oikodomeo. Oikos means house or family. Family. And the word, it comes from the word dome, and the word dome is the Greek word roof. Roof. So when the house of God, we are God's house, when the house of God, when the roof is put on, the house is finished. This is the building of the house of God. What builds us up? Agape is walking in the commandments of God. That takes separating from the world and crucifying self, doesn't it? That's exactly it. Now let's continue here. He says, if any man think that he knoweth anything, he knoweth nothing yet as he ought to know. But if any man love God, the same is known of him. As concerning, therefore, the eating of those things, just before we get into the long hair or the adorned hair, you have to have long hair to adorn it, and you're not supposed to be adorning it. That's what he said when he said, if a man have long hair. It doesn't say have long hair in the original text. It says if the man comedzo, if he adorns his hair. It is a verb. It is not an adjective as it is in the English text. Comedzo, long. The Nazarite was not to be doing anything to his hair. If he defiled it, he was to shave it off. In fact, when Absalom pulled his hair, he disgraced himself. It means to shave. And when it weighed so many shekels, I looked it up last night, and it meant it weighed about 6 pounds. He'd pull it once a year, and it weighed 6 pounds, approximately. Whew, lots of hair in a year, didn't it? Now, as concerning, therefore, the eating of those things that are offered and sacrificed unto idols, we know that an idol is nothing in the world and that there is none other God but one. Now, he's talking about what we eat, isn't he? Before we get to the 11th chapter, you got to look at the eating and drinking of the spiritual Nazarite. Then he says, for though there be that are called gods, whether in heaven or earth, as there be gods many and lords many, but to us there is but one God. He said, these are not gods in these temples, but the Father of whom are all things, and we in him, and one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. Howbeit there is not in every man that knowledge. For some with conscience of the idol unto this hour eat it as a thing offered unto idols. Now what we eat spiritually is the word of God. We're not, what's the idol we offer? What we see in our eyes and hear with our ears, the eyes not satisfied with seeing nor the ear filled with hearing. The Bible says there in Ecclesiastes 1:8 that we will labor to fulfill all that we look and hear. So whatever you look at and what you're listening to is what you're going to be eating of. And their conscience being weak is defiled, but meat commendeth us not to God, for neither if we eat are we the better, neither if we eat not are we the worst. And Paul said in Romans 14, said there's some Jews down there at Rome that are trying to partake of the rituals of the Jews, dietary laws. He said, receive them without disputing with them, even though they don't know yet that that is neither here nor there. That's why he said the handwriting of ordinances were blotted out in Colossians 2:14. Don't let any man judge you in meat or drink or holiday or new moon or a Sabbath day. These were all a shadow. Christ is the very image of it all. Neither if we eat not are we the worst, but take heed lest by any means separate and watch out how you offend people. Watch what you eat, nomos, and drink of, not spiritual drunkenness. Because we are spiritual Nazarites, and before we get to the 11th chapter, you have to see all of the eating and drinking. That this liberty of yours be not a proskoma, P-R-O-S-K-O-M-M-A, P-R-O. S-K-O-M-M-A. I forgot to tell you one thing about apostasy. This word proskoma means apostasy. One of the words for apostasy means divorce. We've divorced Christ. We have become apostate. We've divorced Him. Watch out that you don't cause anybody to go to the apostasy and quit learning the Word of God. That's what we're to be eating and drinking of. The apostasy is no cross. Watch out that you, what you eat or drink is going to cause men to quit. Is going to quit crucifying. That's why when we go into that word adorned, let's just go back to it very quickly in 1 Corinthians 11. There's so much on this, I can't really even get to all this. I said that I'm going to try to stop and just give you some of the words for Nazir in a moment. But go back over here to the 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians. When he says, if a man have long hair, down there, and he's talking about that we're not a stumbling block. He says here in 1 Corinthians 11 and verse 14, doth not even nature itself. The word nature is a word that means to, it's the word phusis, P-H-U-S-I-S, P-H-U-S-I-S. That word phusis, that means lineal descent. That means does not your lineal descendants, your heritage, teach you that if a man, it does not say have long hair, it says that a man komidzo, K-O-M-I-Z-O, komidzo, and from that we get the word K-O-M-E-O, that is the word komeo, and we get a word cameo from that. A cameo, what is a cameo? I didn't say it exactly last week. A cameo out of Webster's is, it is a carving in relief on certain stratified gems or shells so that the raised design often a head in profile. A head. We're talking about heads, aren't we? We're talking about spiritual heads. And what's the spiritual head of man? That's Christ. So cameo has to do with head. That's that word. Now, the word komidzo does not mean to have long hair. I said it last week. I'm going to say it again. The word means to adorn the hair. It reads in the original text, if a man adorn his hair. Now, to adorn hair, that meant to plait it or put it in tresses or to decorate his hair. Wait a minute. The hair upon the head of man, the covering of man is Christ. And when Samson's hair was shaved, it was equated with the Lord. He knew not that the Lord was departed from him. When you decorate your hair spiritually, you're decorating Christ, and you got a real pretty nice Christ, don't you? You got a pretty Jesus. A nice Jesus. That's the other Jesus when you decorate him up. And you pollute him. And you mix Christ with the world, with the Jesus of the world. That's the other Jesus, isn't it? It's what it is. And it doesn't say if a man have long hair. If a man have long hair, I said it last week. Have long hair. Have long hair. That word long in that phrase there is an adjective. Long tells which, what kind of, how many. It modifies nouns and pronouns. It's a modifier. What kind of hair? Long hair. Well, I'm sorry, the word komidzo is not the word, it's not an adjective, it's a verb. It says if a man adorn, it can't be a verb by being long. I said last week, I'm going to long my hair. In its present tense, active voice. You can't long your hair, right? Somebody long your hair. Barry, let me see, long your hair. I can just see that brag goes, whoop, just grows it right out. Huh? Let's watch it. Just go, whoop, just grow right out there. You can't long your hair. He's talking about adorning the long hair. It would be very redundant to say don't adorn your hair if you didn't have long enough hair to adorn, would it? And the hair was said to be a pure thing among the Jews. What he's talking about, and when he goes into the words adorn, that a woman adorn herself, it comes with the word cosmos, cosmeos. We get a word cosmetic from that. The woman is to adorn herself modestly in God, and look godly. not to wear these tight dresses like you go up to some of these big churches and they look like they've had their dresses painted on. And wear clothing that makes all the men lust. Because it does. And the men know it. And these preachers, I used to go to church, a preacher said, liquor's never passed these lips. No. You crook. You liar. Has the lust passed in your mind from watching those women in your church that you never ever preach godly dress? And they looked like they were just poured into it. Now, if you walked up to them, one of you men walked up and said, look, I'm lusting after your body. I can just see all of it right here. I'm lusting. What would the woman say? How dare you? And look at her and say, isn't that why you wore the clothes? Men are turned on by sight. That's something maybe I don't know if women understand that. I'm not a woman. I don't know. And I'm going to say something, and I'm going to be very blunt. When a woman doesn't wear a bra, even though she is covered, the man is turned on by the movement. And all the men are dropping their eyes. You should dress modestly in godly apparel, not uncovering yourself. Maybe we need to start doing like the Puritans and putting a curtain down the middle and put the women on one side and the men on the left. And that way nobody will be looking at anybody else's wife. We don't really understand these things, do we? Our conversation has to be godly. And we need to be dressing correctly and looking right and living right and separated. We are spiritual Nazarites. And if you walk up and said that to somebody, somebody said one time, said, well, you're a Christian, you don't like that. I said, no, you don't understand. I do like that. That's why I can't look at it. And it's hard turning your head away when it's everywhere in this nation, isn't it? Now, you men know exactly what I'm talking about. Does that anger me? It infuriates me that preachers, liquors hasn't plastered these lips, and I got all these women that look like they're just mostly naked out here in the congregation. You hypocrite. You liar. Let's go back over here. Now, he says, look here in verse chapter 8, take heed lest that it by any means this liberty of yours become a stumbling block to them that you cause men to quit apostatizing because what you're eating as a spiritual Nazarite that are weak. For if any man see thee which hast knowledge sit at meat in idols' temple, shall not the conscience of him which is weak be emboldened to eat those things which are offered to idols? They would offer their temples in the temples of Aphrodite, in the temple of Demeter, or Persephone, one of the idols. They would offer meat. Then they would go out into the marketplace and they would sell it in what they call the shambles. The shambles were these little booths in the streets of Corinth. And you might go up and you might buy some meat that was offered to Aphrodite. He said it's not wrong to eat the meat because those are not gods. It's just meat. But if somebody knows what you're about to partake of, how would that equate in this day and time? A new Cadillac. I sold real estate. I know what a new Cadillac, and I know what a new town car means. That means look at me. That's all it means. Because if it didn't, you would buy a new Mercury because they are built on the same chassis as a new town car. It's the same car except for the shell, isn't it? They are the same car. And stupid us, we go out and pay $15,000 more because it says town car on the front. That's why I bought one. And when I drive up, I had a carriage roof, and a blue carriage roof, and pinstripes all over it, and blue floor mats, and white leather interior. And I'd look over the town car, and I'd think, yours is not as nice as mine. How stupid and arrogant and proud Jim Brown has
been. And though the knowledge, and through thy knowledge shall the weak brother perish. He's not talking about dying. He's talking about perishing away from God for whom Christ died. For when you sin against thy brethren and wound their weak conscience, watch out what you're eating of the spiritual Nazarites. You sin against Christ. Wherefore, if meat makes my brother to offend, he's not talking about beef steak. He's talking about what you're partaking of. If wearing a big 5-carat diamond ring makes your brother to offend, you have no business wearing one. Well, that does it. Yes. I will eat no flesh while the world standeth, lest I make my brother to offend. Lest I make him quit carrying his cross and dying, lest I make him to apostatize. Lest I make him divorce Christ. And he says in verse 4 of the following chapter, he says, am I not an apostle in the first verse? Am I not free? Have I not seen Jesus Christ our Lord? Are ye not my work in the Lord? If I be not an apostle unto others, yet doubtless I am to you, for the seal of mine apostleship are ye in the Lord. Mine answer to them that do examine me is this: have we not power to eat and to drink? He's talking about eating and drinking. Isn't that the Nazarite vow? And before we get to the long hair and not adorning the hair, which what Samson did and he got shaved. He's talking about spiritual Nazarites here is what he's talking about. Have we not power to eat and drink? Have we not power to lead about a sister or a wife as well as other apostles and the brethren of the Lord and save us? Watch out how you lead them. You're going to lead them by what you're partaking of. Boy, that's hard. People say, oh, you don't believe in big fancy cars. I don't believe in things that's going to cause my brother to stumble because I have done that as much as anyone. Let's go on over here. I got to get on here. And he says over here in verse 27. If you go through this whole thing, look at verse 11 of chapter 9. If we have sown unto you spiritual things, pneumaticos, it means non-carnal, not fleshly. It is a great thing if we reap your carnal things. And verse 12, if others be partakers of this power over you, are not we rather? Nevertheless, we have not use this power, but suffer all things, lest we should hinder the gospel of Christ. We've got a power. We're not supposed to abuse it. We're supposed to stay separated from the world, eating and drinking. Because Christ is our crown there in the 11th chapter, isn't he? And he says, do you know that they which minister about holy things live of the things of the temple? You have to be holy. And they which wait on the altar are partakers with the altar? Even so hath the Lord ordained that they which preach the gospel should live of it and separate from the world. And watch out what you're eating and drinking. And he said, if I don't keep under my body in verse 27 and bring it under subjection, lest that by any means when I have preached to others, I myself become a castaway. Castaway is that word adokimas, isn't it? A-D-O-K-I-M-A-S. It means a reprobate. It means reprobate silver with silver that was not tried in the fire. No cross, no blood baptism. The blood baptism is a daily cross, and that has to do with separating from the world before we get to the 11th chapter. I have no doubt that what he's talking about, I believe we're going to find in Paul's writings all of the shadows of the Old Testament. Because we're in the spiritual Passover, aren't we, in the 10th chapter? The cup of blessing in verse 6, the third cup of the Passover, was called the cup of blessing. Unleavened bread for 7 days. He's talking about the unleavened bread in the 5th chapter, isn't he? He talks about that spiritual leavened bread that's in the church, that man that's having an affair with his stepmother. Everything Paul says comes from the shadows of the Old Testament. He's talking about Nazarites here. That's us. We're to separate, aren't we? Now, he said, if I don't bring my body in subjection, doulagogeo, D-O-U, L-A-G-O-G-E-O. That word means to enslave oneself to what? What's the subject? Eating and drinking, isn't it? What we're partaking of. Then we get to the crown in the 11th chapter. Now, he says, if I don't bring my body in subjection and enslave myself to the way I am living,
living right. This is not legalism on our part. This is God's legalism, and He demands our obedience to the Word of God. We do have to obey the faith, don't we? And He gets into atonement, the Day of Atonement, here in the, well, the word, did I put it down? Adokimas, A-D-O-K-I-M-A-S. Adokimas, that's the word reprobate. It's the same word as castaway. It comes from D-O-K-I-M-A-Z-O. That word, dokimazo, means to put into a fire or trial. Try the word. Try the spirits. Put everything on trial. Place the alpha privative. It means no in front of it. That means no fire. It gives the opposite meaning. No fire, no trial, no daily cross, no blood baptism. Apostasy. You're not going to learn the Word of God as long as you try to live in the flesh. You can't do it. You can't hold hands with free will and do it. Free will is a lie. Free will is not an alternative to the sovereignty of God. It's not another way of looking at the Bible. It's a lie. I try to hold hands with free will. Look at there. You're in atonement in the second verse of the next chapter, aren't you? Huh? We're in the Day of Atonement there. And they were all baptized unto Moses and did eat the same spiritual meat, verse 3 of chapter 10, eat the spiritual meat and did all drink the same spiritual drink. What's that? That's death to self, isn't it? For they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Christ. Wait a minute. We're talking about Old Testament shadows and types, aren't we? We're still talking about eating and drinking. That's what the Nazarite had to do, and he had to separate himself. But with many of them, God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Now, these things were our examples to the intent we should not lust after evil things as they also lusted, neither be idolaters. Idololatria, idolatry, looking at things and worshiping what you see and look at. But if you're going to parade yourself in front of us with a godless look, men, you are causing men to stumble, women. Let me tell you, you're the biggest weakness that man has. I don't know why in the world a man could love a man. I can't understand that. They're ugly. They look like sticks to me. I'm sorry, Annie, you look like a stick. Jay looks like a stick. You look like a stick. You look like a stick. I just, what's handsome about that?
How about a limb?
I mean, why in the world? I can't understand that. But when those beautiful females walk by,
foxy.
So God made them that way to do things to our mind. And you have no business living like that and dressing like that in front of men. Whatever makes them do that. They say men is the woman's the weaker sex. That ain't true. What did Delilah do? Put a hook in Samson's nose and said, come here, boy. Do this. Women are men's downfall. Women want the things of the world. Man wants the woman.
Women don't understand testosterone.
They do not understand. And let me tell you, that goes on with men, and you can get mad at your husband. God made him like that. And that's why we need to say something to these women. Go home and change your clothes. You're tempting me. That's what preachers ought to say, but they don't have the guts to say it. Now, where was I? Okay. How much time do I have?
11.
Oh, man. I've got to stop here and go to, we're not to seek our own, but look at another man's wealth. And look over here in, look at verse 24 of chapter 10. Let no man seek his own, but every man another's. The word wealth is not there. Whatsoever is sold in the shambles, that was those little, the word is makelon, M-A-K-E-L-L-O-N. It means the stalls in the meat market. That's where they sold that food that was offered to idols. That eat, asking no question for conscience sake. There's nothing wrong with it because those are not gods. They just cooked it for you, he said.
For the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. If any man of them believe not, bid you to a feast, and ye be disposed to go, whatsoever is set before you eat, asking no question for conscience sake, but if any man say unto you, this is offered in sacrifice to idols, and he knows it. If anyone knows what the world looks upon as idolatry, to serve self, eat not for his sake that showed it. What is idolatry in our life? It's all these things that we put in our eyes and ears that we want more of, isn't it? And for conscience sake, for the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. Conscience, I say, not your own, but of the other. For why is my liberty judged of another man's conscience? For if I by grace be a partaker, why am I evil spoken of for that for which I give thanks? He's talking about eating all the way through here, isn't he? Eating and drinking before we get to the adorned hair. And to have adorned hair, you have to have long hair, and that's the crown. Let me just read something very quickly to you from, this is from McClintock and Strong on Nazarite. According to others, the word Nazir, a diadem, contains... Diadem comes from dia. It comes from dia and dio. It's a construction of dia and dio. Dia and dio. Dio, we get the word slave from the word dio. Doulas. This word dio means to bind or to forbid. And when you're Nazarite, you forbidden. You were forbidden. And dia means the channel. Or it actually means a channel of binding oneself, or it can be through or around. To bind around the head. He says, according to the others, the word diadem contains the original idea of Nazir, which will then radically signify to crown. The crown upon the Nazir, the Nazarite, was the hair. And the hair is regarded as a crown to the person. The Nazarite, in that view, is the crowned one because, as we are told in Numbers 6-7, he has the crown of God upon his head. Evidently referring to his distinguishing badge of the freely growing and profuse mass of hair, which was considered an ornament and which he was not allowed to cut off in Numbers 6 and 5 because therein his vow chiefly consisted in Judges 12 and 5, speaking of Samson's vow. And this is confirmed by Numbers 6 and 9 where it is said, if he defiled his head or diadem, he is to shave his head, hence also the signification, ornamental hair, long hair, Jeremiah 7 and 29 with Numbers 6 and 19, while the vine again laden with fruit is called Nazir. Let's look at it. Let's go over to Leviticus 25. Now here is how we separate what we're eating and drinking. Leviticus 25. There's so much more to this, I don't even feel that I'm explaining this sufficiently. This is so overwhelming to see all of this. Leviticus 25. This is about the sabbatical years. Every sabbatical year was a picture of the Nazarite. That was every seven. Seven is the number of baptism, isn't it? And that's a cross. And that's what separates us, right? Have you noticed how all of this just blends together? Let's read here. And the Lord spake unto Moses in Mount Sinai, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, when you come into the land which I give you, Then shall the land keep a Sabbath unto the Lord. 6 years thou shalt sow thy field, and 6 years thou shalt prune thy vineyard, and gather in the fruit thereof. But in the seventh year shall be a Sabbath of rest unto the land, a Sabbath for the Lord. Thou shalt neither sow thy field nor prune thy vineyard. That which groweth of its own accord of thy harvest, thou shalt not reap. Neither gather the grapes of thy vine Nazarite, undressed. It meant the vine that was filled with the fruit, you left it alone. And when we are filled with Christ, we're filled with the fruit of the Spirit. This set word undressed, for it is a year of rest unto the land. Now, how do we fulfill our Nazarite vow? The Sabbath of and the Sabbath of the land shall be meat for you, for thee and for thy servant and for thy maid. We separate, we cease from our own works, don't we? And we crucify self. And for thy hired servant and for thy stranger that sojourneth with thee, we keep the law of God. We separate. And we have a rest, don't we? And we rest from our works. The man that has suffered in the flesh has ceased from his own works. And it's the same word in verse 11. A jubilee shall that 50th year be unto you. Ye shall not sow, neither reap that which groweth of itself in it, nor gather the grapes in it of thy vine undressed. Now, what it was this for? It was for the poor and the downtrodden and the needy. We were not to glean the fields. We were not to beat our olive trees but once. What's the seventh year for? It's to feed others. And what are we going to do? Feed them the Word of God. And we're going to have to watch what we partake of, aren't we? We're going to have to separate and live according to the Word of God. And we're in a daily Sabbath now, aren't we? Yes. Now, he says, he speaks of the year of Jubilee. A Jubilee shall that 50th year be unto you. That was called the acceptable year of the Lord. And what is preached in the acceptable year of the Lord? In Luke 4:18, Jesus said, I came to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. He said, I came to preach the gospel to the poor, the poured out, the emptied out, to the brokenhearted, to the blind, those who cannot see the truth, to the bruised, the crushed. So what we do is we watch out for everyone, and we watch out what we're eating of and partaking of. And we live for them and not self. When man lives for himself, he lives for his own crown. He lives for his own glory. You know what he does? He adorns himself. God crowns us and adorns us with Christ. That's the crown. That's the glory. That's upon our head as a spiritual Nazarite. I said to you a while ago, let's look at it. Let's go over here to Genesis, that Joseph was the first Nazarite in the Bible. And the reason I say that, in 49th chapter, now, the vine undressed, that word undressed is the same word as Nazarite, Nazir. Chapter 49, Jacob's name was changed to Israel. And Joseph had just given the portion to his two sons, Manasseh and Ephraim. Ephraim receives the inheritance of all Israel. So when the Bible speaks of Joseph, it is talking about Manasseh and Ephraim. It says here in verse 22 of chapter 49, Joseph is a fruitful bough. Wait a minute. The undressed vine is fruitful bough, isn't it? Isn't that right? Huh? Do y'all understand that? The undressed vine is the Nazarite. What it means undressed, it doesn't mean clothes. It means certainly we're clothed with Christ. It means the vine that has not been harvested. We've got the fruit. Joseph is going to feed. Who was it that fed Israel? Who fed them? Huh? It was Joseph, wasn't it? He was sold. He said, you thought evil of me. God meant it for good. And when the seven good years and then the seven bad years came, he fed them, didn't he? Joseph will have the inheritance of all Israel, won't he? He will be the owner of Israel. He will feed. And the head of the household fed the rest of the family. Because he will be a vine. He will be a fruitful bough. And isn't that what he is? Isn't he a fruitful bough? Isn't he the one that's feeding Israel? Let me go out back there. Even a fruitful bough by a well whose branches run over the wall. The archers have sorely grieved him and shot at him and hated him. But his bow abode in strength, and the arms of his hands were made strong by the hands of the mighty God of Jacob. From thence is the shepherd, the stone of Israel, even by the God of thy fathers, who will help thee, and by the Almighty, who shall bless thee with the blessing of heaven above. Blessings of the deep that lieth under, blessings of the breast and of the womb, the blessings of thy father have prevailed above the blessings of my progenitors unto the utmost bound. And who's going to bound Israel? Joseph. Why? He will be the owner. He receives all the ownership. Since Reuben the firstborn had defiled his birthright, and Joseph, the firstborn of the hated wife, always that was the one who would receive the inheritance. He says, unto the utmost bound, we think of horizo, don't we? And we're going to be separated according to the boundary of Joseph. Ephraim held the, and that's the youngest son, the secondborn son of Joseph. He has the boundary line of Israel. He possesses it. Of the everlasting hills, Moriah, Zion, those are the everlasting hills. Spiritual Zion, heavenly Jerusalem, the church of the firstborn. Now read on. And they shall be on the head of Joseph. Whoops. And on the crown of the head of him that was Nazir, the first Nazarite of the Scripture. You see, God's laws pertain before he writes them down in Scripture, don't they? Why do you think Abel offered a blood sacrifice? Because Adam told him he had to. He told Abel and Cain they had to. But Cain offered the works of his hands. Joseph was the first Nazarite, and the crown was upon his head, wasn't it? This whole thing is about a crown. And our crowns are not... I've got crowns here. The Bible doesn't ever talk. The Stephanos was the oak leaf. 1 Corinthians 9:25. They do it for a corruptible crown. We do it for a crown incorruptible. Philippians 4:1. This is each time the word Stephanos is used. He says, you are my joy and crown. Philippians. 1 Thessalonians 2:19. He speaks of a crown of rejoicing, of kara. Then in 2 Timothy 4:8, a crown of righteousness, dikaiosune, justification, declared right, declared innocent. That's the crown upon our head. That's the hair upon our head. That's what we wear. We wear Christ upon our heads. We're crowned with Christ. The hair was considered the crown. And he says, when you're crowned, when God adorns our head, he adorns us with Christ. Don't decorate ourselves. Don't be seen. When a man prays or prophesies, he needs to, his head, Christ needs to be uncovered. But when the woman prays or prophesies, the only one who gets glory is Christ. Our glory is to be covered up, isn't it? Our kabod, our doxa. And the crown was, that's what the crown was on the head of the Nazarite. It was the hair. It was called a crown. And what is the hair upon our head? It was equated with the Lord had departed from Samson. Our crown is Christ. It's not pointed crowns. When I get to heaven, how would you like to go compare crowns with Paul? Well, look at my crown, Paul. See, I got these 4 points up here, and it's got some rubies and gold in it. And he says, I've got a closet that's 5 miles long, and it's walk-in on both sides, and I got all these crowns. See, if it was man doing it, you'd be going around hiding your Oh, there's Paul. Oh, hi, Paul. You want to hide, wouldn't you? And then a crown of life in James 1 and 12. 1 Peter 5 and 4, a crown of glory. He's talking about spiritual, being a spiritual Nazarite, because if you notice, before we get to the 11th chapter, before he talks about adorning the hair, we talked about that last week. He's not talking about it's shame for man to have long hair. It's not long. It's not the word long. The word in the Greek for long, meaning lengthy, is the word makros. M-A-K-R-O-S. That would have been makros, but it's not. It's the word komedzo. It comes from komeo. And the kome was the tonsure that the pagans wore. They always decorated their hair in the form of their gods. That becomes our god. I think that's the biggest god we've got is our hair. We know we can't change our face. We can change this. Until you get to where you don't care about your hair. Until you get to where you can do this. Whew. You couldn't have got me. I'd have killed you if you'd done that when I was 30. I said, oh. Punch your lights up for messing with my hair. I want to walk the aisle at Charles Stanley's church and walk down there and go, Brother Stanley, got you. Combs that hair over all over the side. I just want to flip it over to one side. So, got your glory, didn't I? Huh? Revelation 2:10, crown of life. Revelation 3:11, that no man take thy crown, shave Christ from you as a spiritual Nazarite. That's what this is all about, people. It's not about... Is my hair messed up enough? There. There, now. That better?
An evangelical told my uncle that was not five crowns. They actually teach that.
No, they're stupid. They're stupid. It's dumb. Besides that, what we get is a Stephanos. We get the word Stephen or Stephanie from that.
Hey. Is that the tiara?
Yeah, I'm sure it is. That would be called a tiara. But it's not the diadem. That means the binding around the head. That's the hair. See? And you know what? And isn't our hair about the most vain thing that we have? And that was the most vanity that they had among the Jews. I've got so many more words on Nazir. I've got a bunch of words. That is the word Nazir, but I don't have time to go to them. Deuteronomy 33:16 is the word separated. It's the word Nazir. Lamentations 4:7, you find the Nazir. Amos 2:11 and 12, you find the Nazir. And you got, y'all can have a copy of this. It's got the Nazir. And this is our considering the poor is what it is. What we do is I was talking to Keith about this yesterday when he said, I was in prison and you visited me. The word prison is philake. It means to be taken from light to darkness, from darkness to light. That's the division of light and darkness, and that's where we go from to truth, and we're separated from darkness. What was I going to give you? I sit and went blank. What was I talking to you about?
Clothing.
Huh? Clothing. He said, I was in visited. He said, I was in prison, and you visited me. Prison doesn't mean literal prisons. It means in darkness, and you visited me. He said, let's just look at that and we'll quit. Look over here in Matthew 25. He's not talking about literal prisons, and we're not supposed to be going around feeding. God's first judgment is famine, isn't it? Famine and fasting is not the same thing. He was talking about, huh? It all comes together. Wait a minute now, here. I was going to go back to the 11th chapter. Now, 25, over here in verse 31, when the Son of Man shall come in His glory and all the holy angels with Him, that He shall sit upon the throne of His glory. And that's in our hearts, certainly. He's there now. And before Him shall be gathered all nations, He shall separate them one from another. There we are, and we're going to be the separated ones, aren't we? As a shepherd divideth his sheep from the goats, and he shall set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on the left. Then shall the king say unto them on the right hand, Come ye blessed of my Father, and inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungered and gave me meat. What meat did we give? Nomos. We're not to be cheerful or communicate with people who will not receive the word of God. I'll feed somebody on the streets once. I'll never give them money. I'll take them down. If some guy's begging, I say, what do you need? He says, I'm hungry. I say, go down here and I'll buy you a meal. And I've done that many times and I'll pay for it, but I will not give him money. Watch out who you give your money to. There's too much con going out there in the world. I was thirsty and you gave me to drink. What did we give him to drink? The blood of Christ, pure water. We drink of the cup. We die to self, don't we? I was stranger, and he said, you took me in. What was a stranger? A Gentile unbeliever coming to Christ. That's what a stranger was called in the house of Abraham. The message, a God being a God to Abraham was extended to the stranger in Genesis, the 17th chapter, to the Gentile. It was hidden through the ages. Naked and you clothed me. Clothed means to put on. What do we clothe with? The blood baptism, don't we? As many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on, and we ain't talking about being dipped in water, H2O. A blood baptism was a death. We're clothing them with the daily cross, aren't we? I was sick, asthenia. That means to be feeble in any sense. We're downtrodden. He said, I was sick and you visited me. And that word visited is episkeptomai. We get the word episcopate. That's where the word episcopal comes from. It means to shepherd someone. It means to be an overseer. That's what he said in James 1:27. He said, pure religion, threskia, ritual, and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless, the orphanos. Same word, John 14. I'll not leave you comfortless. Visit the fatherless. I'll send a comforter and take them, the comforter, the Holy Spirit, the truth. Visit the fatherless and the widow, the Kira, one without a husband. Christ is gone, the husband of the church, in their affliction. To visit, episkeptomai, or episcopate. Epi and scopeo. It means scope, we say scope this out, or skeptomai. It means to look over. Epi, to completely epi, over, look over people, watch over them. That's what the word visit means. That's pure religion, not dipping in water, not Christ Mass. To visit the fatherless and the widow, one without a husband, that's the church. Visit them, episkeptomai, episcopate. Be a good Episcopal. And we're not talking about down here at the Episcopal Church. To look over the sheep, in there, he said, you visited me, I was in prison, you came unto me. Then the righteous say, where did we do this? He said, inasmuch as you've done it unto one of the least of these, you become a spiritual Nazarite, because on the seventh year you've left the vine undressed and you've taken care of the widow and the orphans, and that's what that was for. We're going to have to stop here. I feel so inadequate trying to preach this. I don't know how to do this. It's just, I have not even begun on this subject. I don't know what. God help me. Let's pray. Father, help us to understand your word. You're such a magnificent God. You've given us so much. I don't know what to say, Lord. I feel so failing in this word. There's too much, Lord. You should send an angel from heaven to preach this. It's more than I can do. Help us to understand your word. It's overwhelming. Why would you call us? What are we that you're mindful of us, God? Help us to see. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.